Angels and Airwaves is more than just a catchy name for Tom DeLonges Band. It's a nod to the visitors and the signal they put out. This will be the most unusual story you hear today. Small G Gods is the subject of Gods by Tom DeLonge and Peter Levenda, a book where aliens are reframed as angels, demons, and small g gods. This extraterrestrial small g god was also the subject of the Marvel movie Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
A celestial like a god?
Small g, son. At least on the days I'm feeling humble as Drax.
The release dates were March 7th, 2017, and May 5th, 2017, less than 2 months apart. Coincidence or by design? And if by design, whose design? The synchronicities I am about to share surprised me all along the way of my research, and if correct, will help add some color to the incredible visitors in our skies. Important to this story is the question, how do you receive the airwaves of the angels? You learn to listen to your heart, and this is where our story begins.
One time, Oliver, I was flying. It was in a time where I had just a couple years earlier learned to fly. So I was still in a period in my life where any excuse to fly would do. He wanted to go to Phoenix to see a friend, and I said, "Sure, I'll fly."
Oh, really? Okay.
So we flew to. My dad wouldn't drive me to the mall, by the way.
In Peter Levenda's research journal for Gods, we find an entry on the alien mind and time. Quote. Evidence of and contact with alien forces intersect non-linearly. We experience time and hence understand history in a linear fashion. But alien influence intersects with our linear experience, but is not in itself linear. There are two diagrams accompanying the entry. The first is a diagram showing a UFO arriving at Earth at two different times, juxtaposed on a linear timeline as we humans perceive it. Today, we look back in history and see the UFOs in 1947 and 1952. Humans understand these events linearly from past history to today. In the second diagram, Levenda is illustrating that the alien on the craft does not define itself as visiting Earth in 1947 or 1952. That was simply when it chose to physically appear. The alien forces see the people in 2016 reading about it. It sees the sighting in 1947 and 1952. And the being can also see any other associated moments that it chooses, before or after. The journal puts it that the alien panopticon, not in center of a space, but in center of time, in eternal present. Let me try and unpackage that. A panopticon is a prison design where the guards are in the middle and the entire prison can be seen in 360 degrees around it. In the same way, the alien is in the middle of all time, watching those of us who are trapped in the linear experience around the outside. The guard tower of the Panopticon, incidentally, is how the Guardians broke out of prison in the first movie. The takeaway is that time is not linear to these beings. To them, all time happens simultaneously, and so they can influence all times simultaneously to craft an experience for a person or population which we perceive over time. And although we perceive it over time as linear, time's not linear, brah. Occasionally, the influence causes the Mandela effect, things which are different than we remember, like the Berenstain Bears becoming the Berenstain Bears. We will talk about that phenomenon in an upcoming video about memory. This brings us back to Kurt Russell's trip to Phoenix and the Small G Gods. On March 13, 1997, the single largest mass sighting of a UFO took place over Phoenix, Arizona. 20,000 calls flooded the phone lines of officials demanding answers. And officials, having been told by the government and military that none of this phenomenon was real, mocked the single largest sighting in U.S. history in a press conference, a decision the governor later regretted having seen the craft himself.
What did you see?
Well, I saw a huge craft just kind of come right over Squaw Peak. It was just breathtaking.
There's a little known Kurt Russell connection to this event, and I'd like to expand on it for a moment. When we use the phrase to follow our heart, what is being described is your egoless and open connection to your consciousness, which picks up the airwaves we might call love. This is why we associate love with listening to our heart. Kurt Russell loved to fly, and he loved his son, and so he did the only thing he could do on March 13, 1997. He followed his heart and jumped in the plane heading to Phoenix.
So we flew to
My dad wouldn't drive me to the mall, by the way. Maybe bowling, that was it.
So we're going into Phoenix, and I think it was Sky Harbor, and there's these bank of lights, six lights, in the shape of a triangle going back right over the airport. And I'm looking at them as I'm coming in. I'm, you know, on the horn talking to them, and I'm coming in. And I'm not saying anything about it because I'm kind of confused by it, but I can't tell if this is going to be an issue or not with landing. And Oliver said, hey, Pa, what are those lights? And I said, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what they are. And so anyway, I called up the tower and I said, what are you guys painting tonight over the airport? And they said, we're not showing anything. What are you seeing? I said, well, there's six lights in a row. And they said, do you want to report this? And I said, look, I can't identify it. It's flying and it's six objects. So that's what it is, right? So we landed. I dropped him off, flew home. Years later, I come home and Goldie's watching this show on UFOs. And the most reported one of all time was this one in Phoenix. And I'm watching, I start to see this show and I said, wait a minute, that's the night Ollie and I were landing in Phoenix. I remember that. And I said, wait a minute, I've got it in my logbook. So I went to my logbook and I didn't mention anything about the reporting the UFO, but my flight was logged. So I said, yeah, and on the show they talked about 20,000 people reporting it and only one general aviation pilot. And I said, that's me.
Right, so. Sky Harbor is a busy airport. Given the stigma of UFOs at the time, it is understandable that only one pilot called the tower. It's just that at 20,000 to 1, we should appreciate more deeply the significance of that one pilot. And in particular, who that one pilot was. A small G god flew a massive craft over Phoenix in the largest mass sighting in U.S. history. And I contend that these small G gods chose Kurt Russell, a future small G god himself, to meet them in the skies over Phoenix and let the guys in the tower know they said hi. We've termed this phenomenon of interaction as the Kurt Russell effect in honor of him. Moments of interaction with the phenomenon, resulting in experiences of deep synchronicity in one's life. Kurt Russell did not know he was going to play a small G god someday, but I promise you, the small G gods did. A tangent to the Kurt Russell effect is the Kurt Vonnegut effect. The Kurt Vonnegut effect is a synchronicity within an artist's work representing a manifestation of the phenomenon. Vonnegut's distinction comes from having published The Alien Time Perspective in Slaughterhouse-Five in 1969. Quote, the most important thing I learned on Tralfamador was that when a person dies, he only appears to die. He is still very much alive in the past, so it is very silly for people to cry at his funeral. All moments, past, present, and future, always have existed, always will exist. If you have read Slaughterhouse-Five, you have experienced the Kurt Vonnegut effect, the communication of a concept by an extraterrestrial without knowing it, through art. Noodle that one for a while. Because strange can't be strange enough, Kurt Russell also has a craft in Guardians of the Galaxy, which is, oddly enough, in the shape of a Tic Tac. I believe we are two episodes into Tom DeLonge's History Channel show, Unidentified, and the primary subject has been a Tic Tac-shaped craft. A quick thank you to those who helped correct me. This is the gimbal craft, and this is the Tic Tac craft. Small G gods ride around in Tic Tacs. We humans are riding around in the other one. That's the lesson I got, anyway. I'm not in any way saying that Tom DeLonge and Marvel Studios are collaborating. What I am saying is that I have no doubt who picked the actor to play the small G god in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. They met one night in the sky over Phoenix. If it's not true, it makes great fiction. Ancient myths did say, after all, man was the plaything of the gods. Angels and Airwaves music has convinced me that Tom has experienced not only the Kurt Russell effect, but his music is an emanation of the Kurt Vonnegut effect. He has been inspired to write a song asking us to spread hope like fire. The glow from that fire can truly light the world. Please click the love button, comment, share, and subscribe. Peace.